Is the slide visible?
Yes, sir.
So today we will deal with the further aspects of DC motor, back EMF and torque equation. Okay. So before that, a small part is left about the classification. We have seen shunt and series motors classification. Now I have to look into the compound motor. Okay. So shunt motor was having a field winding in parallel to the supply and armature. Series motor is having a field winding in series with supply and armature. Now compound motor is one which are having both the windings. Okay, so compound motor, this have, okay, this motor has both series and shunt winding. Okay. Now, how I place this series and shunt winding will make the motor as a long shunt compound motor or short shunt compound motor. Okay. Now, a long shunt compound motor A long shunt compound motor will be in such a way. This is armature. A series winding will be in series with armature. And shunt winding will be in parallel with the supply. So this is supply voltage V plus minus, this is IL, this is ISH, and this is IA. Okay, so this is known as a long shunt motor. Okay, then short shunt motor short shunt compound motor. Okay. Short shunt compound motor will be in such a way that the series winding will be in series with supply and shunt winding will be in parallel with armature. So this is short shunt motor plus minus V. So this is RSC, this is RSC, this is RSH, RSH, and this is ISH, this is IA. Okay, so this is the difference between long shunt compound motor and short shunt compound motor, where both the windings are present in this compound machine. Okay. Now, again in compound motor, we have cumulative and differential. That depends upon how do I connect this two field windings. Cumulative connection, it is actually cumulative connection. Okay, so here, if the flux produced by shunt field winding and series field winding are additive, then that is called cumulative connection. Okay, here flux produced by shunt and series field winding. Is additive. Then differential, it is understood, both are subtractive. Differential connection here, flux produced by shunt and series field winding are subtractive. Okay. So if the flux produced by this field winding is phi SH and phi SC, this phi SH and phi SC are additive, then that is called cumulative connection. And that is possible in a long shunt also and in short shunt also. Okay. This is possible in long shunt motor as well as short shunt motor. And a differential connection is also possible in long shunt motor and short shunt motor. So compound motor can be a long shunt differential or a long shunt cumulative, a short shunt differential or a short shunt cumulative. That all depends upon what is my application. So when we study the characteristic of these motors, we will understand where all we can apply these motors for application. So depending upon my requirement, I can choose the motor, okay, and I can choose the connection, whether I want a differential connection or I want a cumulative connection. Okay, so this is all about the classification of DC machine. Okay, this is all about the classification of DC machine. Okay, next we'll move to back EMF or counter EMF. Back EMF or counter EMF. Now, I will take a diagram here. I need some figure. I will use this one. So let this be the motor. Right. Now we know this motor is rotating. There are many conductors in each armature slot. These all conductors are producing force, and as a result, the armature started rotating. Okay, now the armature is rotating. Now we have, this is north pole, south pole, north pole and south pole. I have the magnetic field. This is magnetic path. Okay, these are not lungs, because these days we are only worried about this structured biology of our body, lungs. Okay, so this is magnetic field. This is flux phi existing from north pole to south pole. Now this armature is rotating. Okay, this armature is rotating due to motor action. What is happening when the armature is rotating? We observe the armature conductors. These armature conductors, when they are rotating in armature due to motor action, are also cutting this main flux continuously. Is it so? Sir, in class mugse call martha. Okay. So these conductors which are rotating in the armature, so these armature conductors are also cutting these main flux lines. Now when the conductors cut the main flux, or when the conductor cut the flux lines, what should happen? As per the laws of electromagnetic induction, EMF has to be induced in the conductors, right? So these conductors which are producing the force are also cutting the flux, and EMF is getting induced in these conductors. So now in armature there is a supply voltage and there is an induced voltage. So the total voltage available across the armature is the effective voltage of supply voltage as well as induced voltage. Now this induced voltage is due to electromagnetic induction. I can't help avoiding this. This will happen. Electromagnetic induction will happen because a conductor is physically rotating in a magnetic field. So any conductor is continuously cutting the flux. Any conductor is continuously cutting the flux. Hence, in all the conductors, the EMF is getting induced. Now, since this EMF is induced electromagnetically, by the nature, it has to oppose its own cause. We have seen Faraday's law and Lenz's law of electromagnetic induction in one of the fundamental classes. Whenever anything that is induced electromagnetically, it has to oppose its own cause. So, because these conductors are now rotating in a magnetic field, cutting the flux, and EMF is getting induced in these conductors, this induced EMF is now opposing its cause, and cause of this induced EMF is the supply voltage. Because unless and until I give supply voltage, motor will not rotate. If motor will not rotate, the EMF is not induced in the conductors. So this induced EMF has to oppose the cause of its production, that is supply voltage. Now, because this induced EMF is opposing the applied voltage, okay, it is known as counter EMF or back EMF. Okay, so what is happening here? Once again, I will repeat. When the motor starts rotating, the armature conductors are continuously experiencing the change in flux because they are cutting the flux lines. As a result of this flux cut, the EMF is continuously induced in armature conductors, and because this EMF induced is electromagnetic in nature, it will oppose its main cause as per the Lenz law. The main cause for production of this EMF is supply voltage or applied voltage, and it will oppose it. So this induced EMF will oppose the applied voltage, okay, that is V. Because this induced EMF is opposing the applied voltage V, it is known as back EMF or counter EMF. Okay, and this back EMF or counter EMF is generated exactly in the same way as the EMF is generated in the generator. There is no change. Okay, there what we do in DC generator, we keep the armature conductors, we provide the field supply, and we give mechanical input through prime mover. Okay, so there also all the armature conductors are cutting the flux lines, and an EMF is induced in the conductor, armature conductors. So here what is happening, I am not connecting any prime mover. The motor, the armature is rotating due to motor action, and EMFs and the armature conductors are continuously cutting the flux lines. Hence, the EMF is induced in the armature conductors. So the way this EMF is induced in the armature conductor is same as that in generator. This is also known as armature induced EMF or armature generated EMF. And because this is opposing the applied voltage, it is called back EMF or counter EMF. So what is counter EMF or back EMF? Briefly, in one line, we can write here is as. Okay, it is EMF induced in armature conductors as armature rotates and conductors are cutting flux. Okay, so this is what it is, an EMF induced in armature conductor as armature rotates and conductors are cutting flux. Okay, now this EMF induced or is induced electromagnetically and it opposes its main cause. Okay, that is, it opposes applied voltage. That is, it opposes applied voltage. Hence, it is known as, or hence, this induced EMF is known as back EMF or counter EMF. Because it is acting back on the supply or applied voltage, or it is existing counter to the supply voltage. Hence, it is called as back EMF or counter EMF. Okay. And the way how it is induced in the motor is exactly the same way as the EMF is induced in the generator. So the equation for back EMF is exactly the EMF equation of DC generator. What is the EMF equation of DC generator? Anybody?
Pi Z N P upon 60A.
So the EMF equation for the back EMF is the same. Okay. So here we'll write here. The way in which the back EMF is induced, the name is back EMF because it is acting back to this applied voltage. Actually, this is armature generated EMF only. The way in which back EMF is induced in motor is same as generated EMF in DC generator. Okay, therefore, back EMF is given by It is known as EB. EB is equals to Phi Z N by 60 into P divided by A. Okay, phi is written by 16 to p divided by a. So what is phi? It is flux per pole z, number of armature conductors n, speed of motor in RPM p, number of poles and a, number of parallel paths. So exactly there is no change in the equation of back EMF when compared to the generated EMF EA in DC generator, because the way how they are generated is the same. Okay, and this is the EMF, back EMF, which will keep the DC motor operation self-regulating and stable. If back EMF would have not been there, then DC motor would never have been operated. It would have been never in existence only. So it is this back EMF which is making the DC motor operation very much stable. Okay, so very much stable and self-regulating. We'll see, and we see the significance of back EMF there, we'll see. Okay, I told in one of the previous class when we defined Lenz law, it is because of the opposition in the electromagnetic system due to induced EMFs or induced quantities that the entire electrical network or system is stable. Okay, now what happens if there is no back EMF, if there is no counter action of the induced EMF or opposition to the applied voltage? We'll analyze that in forthcoming topic. Okay, is it clear? Is the back EMF point clear to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so next we'll move to voltage equation of DC motor. Remember one thing, when we deal with the machines which will give out the electrical output, we have the EMF equations. Okay, we have the EMF equations, and when we deal with the machines that give out the mechanical output, that exactly the motors, actually we have torque equations. The output of motor is torque. Okay, the output of generator and transformer is electricity. So there we have EMF equation, here we have torque equation. Okay, so before that, before going to the torque equation exactly, we have to look into the voltage equation of DC motor, because that will lead to the torque equation. And it is not EMF equation. Please, you should make a point here. Voltage equation is not a EMF equation. EMF equation comes into picture when there is an induced EMF that is acting upon the load. But here the load is mechanical. So EMF induced is not acting upon the load. Torque is acting upon the load. Hence, the torque equation is important for us in motors. Okay. So next we move to voltage equation of DC motor. And one suggestion from my side to study any subject, you can't study any subject isolatedly. You should keep this in mind. Every subject what you study in this entire engineering course are interrelated. Okay? Because when you want to exactly understand what the motor is, if you already studied the generator, it is better to remember all those things. Because lot of comparisons will come, and when we do the comparative study, if I try to remember the things comparatively, then the memory requirement in my brain is very less. I need not to crack my head for large memory requirement and remembering more things. Okay, if I study each and every topic and subject isolatedly, that if you think that motors is nowhere connected to any other subject anytime, then you have to dedicate a separate amount of memory for remembering these things. Likewise in all other subjects. Okay, all electrical subjects are interrelated. All electrical subjects are interrelated. So you should be always having the ability of comparative study. So what will happen with this is, one thing, you will quickly understand the subject. Second thing, you need not to remember each and every point all the time. When that point is struck in your mind, you will get the answer automatically. So this way you have to start studying. And especially this will help you in operational amplifier subject, because you will get numerous number of circuits there in that subject. If you don't do the comparative study there, then you will end up in by hearting or remembering each and every circuit, which is a small modification of previous circuit. Okay. Yeah. Coming back to this motor. Okay. Now the circuit symbol of motor, I represent a DC motor. Let us consider a DC shunt motor. Okay. Let us consider. Consider a DC shunt motor. So here, let V be the supply voltage and I have a shunt field winding here, ISH, the resistance is RSH, IL be the line current, IA be the armature current, okay. Armature is having some resistance RA, and a back EMF is constantly acting opposite to that, the supply voltage. This is the exact circuit diagram of a DC motor. I have to show this EB opposite direction to that of the supply voltage. Then only it is DC motor, because when the DC motor operates, back EMF is bound to occur. There is no rescue. Okay. So other things we know or we'll write. Okay. V is applied voltage. IL line current, it is not load current. Okay. ISH is shunt field current. IA armature current. Okay. RA armature resistance. Armature resistance is of very small value because it has to carry large armature current. So copper losses, to keep it low, armature resistance are kept very low. Okay. Then EB, back EMF. EB is back EMF. Now observe that EB is acting opposite to the supply voltage in armature, and the voltage across shunt field coil is exactly equal to the supply voltage V. Is it? A shunt field winding is in parallel to applied voltage or supply terminals. Yes or no? So the voltage across shunt field winding is same as applied voltage. And what is the voltage across armature? The voltage across armature is not the supply voltage, it is the back EMF. Okay. And this back EMF is in series with a resistance RA. Can I draw an electrical equivalent circuit of this? Now this is the circuit symbol of motor. But if I want to analyze, I can't use circuit symbols. I want electrical models. The best example what I can give is in the last semester in AC, you replaced the transistor with what? RE model or pi model or H model? Do you remember? You remember that in AC, you replaced the transistor with the models. You used RE model or you used hybrid model?
Yes, yes.
Why you have to model that?
For H equivalent.
For analysis. Okay. There for H equivalent. But generally, when I want to model anything, I model it for analysis. And many subjects what we study the circuit models. In the last semester ECA, what I took, we studied so many circuits. From where those circuits have come from? Are those the circuits which are arbitrarily chosen? No doubt, for the sake of studying and practicing, some circuits values are given. But if you really want to understand a system which is physical in nature, how you will get circuit model? You have to deduce that, right? If I say that, go and analyze a transmission network. What is there in transmission network if you go and see outside? There is a generator, which is mechanical structure. There is a transformer, which is also a mechanical structure. There are conductors, underground or overhead, which are also mechanical structures. There are gaps between conductors. There is gap between conductor and the ground. There are insulators, which are also mechanical structures. So if I give you a generator, a conductor, a insulator, a transformer, will you analyze? Yes? Or what you do? You try to get equivalent circuits, right?
Yes, sir.
That was the reason why you conducted so many tests on transformer last time. OCAC test, Sumner's test. What we did there? We conducted few tests on the transformer and we tried to get the electrical quantities. Those are deciding the performance of those transformers. So as a result, what I got? I got an equivalent circuit referred to either primary or referred to either secondary. So once I get an equivalent circuit, what all things I know from that? I know what is the applied voltage. I know what is the primary current. I know what is the primary resistance, referred to primary resistance, referred to primary reactance. Okay. And with some analysis, I know the losses. From that, I can get the efficiency. By knowing resistance and reactance, I can find the voltage regulation. I know what is the voltage drop. What else we want in electrical system? It is voltage, current, and power. Yes? Did we do the same thing in ECA? You take any circuit you studied in ECA. Did we do only these three? Current, voltage, and power? Did we do anything else than this? Did you find out torque in any circuit? Did you find out heat in any circuit? Did you find out light in any circuit? No, right? We always were interested to find either the current or the voltage or the power, right? So these are the three electrical quantities which will decide the entire performance of anything that I have in my hand. How do I get this? I need a model. I need a model which will make these quantities exist or show that these quantities exist in the system. And that model is a circuit model. This is one type of model. What we do in practicals is physical model. Physically, I am operating a motor. Physically, I am checking the current. Physically, I am applying the load. Physically, I am finding the losses. Physically, I am finding the regulation, efficiency, heat, current, voltage, whatever. So what we do in practicals in lab is physical model. What we do in class is circuit model. Now if I want to feed this data into computers, then circuit model is not sufficient. Then I have to go for a mathematical model, where the entire system is only an equation. The entire system is only an equation. Okay, so there are three models. One is physical model, second is circuit model, third is mathematical model. Okay, so mathematical models you study majorly in control systems when you go to sixth semester classes. There we come across a lot of mathematical models. We have to model a physical system into a mathematical equation. Okay, there you will study the mathematical modeling. Other than that, generally we don't study mathematical modeling anywhere in any subject in UG courses. In PG courses, there are many subjects where you study mathematical modeling. Okay, we study only the circuit model. Now, whatever the circuit I have drawn on the screen now, this is not a circuit model. This is the circuit representation of DC motor. Okay. Now, when I draw the next circuit, you will appreciate what is circuit model. Observe here, the voltage across shunt field coil is exactly the supply voltage. What is the voltage across armature? It is a back EMF. Now, can I represent this back EMF as a EMF source or a battery, which is acting opposite to supply voltage in series with RA? I will draw and I will you will appreciate it. Okay, so here I can show that or I can say that in above circuit we observe, in above circuit we observe that in above circuit voltage across shunt coil or shunt winding is supply voltage. Voltage across shunt field winding is applied voltage. Okay. Next, voltage across armature is back EMF. Is back EMF opposing supply voltage. Opposing applied voltage. Okay. In series with RA. In series with RA. Okay. Now I can say, therefore, here EB can be realized. This is only on paper, okay? EB can be realized as a DC source acting opposite to V. So I will draw therefore the circuit model of a DC motor, of a DC shunt motor, is here shunt field winding, you can show a resistance or you can show a coil. It doesn't make any difference because supply voltage is DC. RSH, RA, EB. IL, ISH. Now, anywhere this right side circuit is appearing as machine, or it is a simple two loop circuit that we studied in ECA. Yes?
Simple, sir.
Is this a simple similar circuit that we studied in circuit analysis many a times? So this is how these circuits will emerge from the physical systems. Okay. This is how the circuit will emerge from the physical systems. Okay, so circuits are not the arbitrary representation of anything which is imaginary. No, circuits in practice are always have emerged from the physical systems. Okay, so many circuits we see in the textbooks, just to have the practice of understanding the concept. That's it. Okay, but when you see the, when you want to analyze any circuit practically, you will appreciate all the concepts will apply at once only. The best example I will give last time, in the case study questions, test one, I have given the equivalent circuit of single phase transformer. Do you remember? Which had got the series parallel combination of the AC components. Okay, so there you were supposed to apply the machine concepts also to find the secondary current, and also circuit analysis techniques also to find the other parameters of the circuit. So no subject is isolated from one another. Every subject includes every subject of study. So this way you have to study, or else it becomes very difficult for you to remember, understand and apply. Main problem is apply. You may understand, you may remember, but when it comes for application, you may fail because you haven't related the application with the concept. Always you try to do this. Okay. Now, what is the voltage equation? I want V in terms of other circuit parameters, or EB in terms of other circuit parameters. Now, voltage across the shunt field is the same as that of V. Okay. Now, simply apply KVL to armature loop. Apply KVL to armature loop. What I get? V minus IRA minus EB is equals to zero, or V equals to EB plus IRA. Call this as equation one. Or EB equals to V minus IRA, equation two, or IRA equals to V minus IRA. EB, equation 4. Okay. Now observe the back EMF from equation 2 is not equal to supply voltage. Back EMF in DC motor is always lesser than by voltage drop in armature when compared to supply voltage. Okay. So you can write EB is lesser than applied voltage by amount of armature drop. There are various other drops. Here I have considered only armature resistance drop. There is brush contact drop. There is armature reaction drop. Okay, there are two other voltage drops in armature. Okay, we should remember that. Okay, so back EMF is never greater than or equals to applied voltage. It is always lesser than the applied voltage by amount of voltage drop in the armature. By amount of voltage drop in the armature. Okay, so how can I give IA? Therefore, from equation 4, IA is equals to, I can write V minus EB divided by RA. Equation 4 or 3, that is? Sorry, this is equation 3. From equation 3, IA is equal to V minus EB divided by RA. Now observe, once I start operating machine by applying some voltage, V remains constant. And once I manufacture the machine, RA remains constant. So for any machine operating, V and RA are constants, and IA, the armature current, is solely depending upon back EMF. For any operating machine or for any machine or for any motor, V and RA are constants. This observation is very important for us. For any motor, V and RA are constants. Therefore, armature current depends solely on back EMF. How it will depend, we'll study again. But it depends on back EMF. Okay? Now, what is back EMF? (60×P/A). Okay. Now observe the RHS of this equation. As long as applied voltage is constant, my flux will remain constant. Why? Because as long as applied voltage is constant, my ISH is constant. As long as ISH is constant, my flux is constant. So DC shunt motors are known as constant flux motors. DC shunt motors are known as constant flux motors because the flux will not change. What is ISH here? Equals to, it is V divided by RSH. So V is standard voltage input, RSH is the resistance of the shunt field winding. It won't change when it is in operation. So V by RSH is a constant. Therefore, flux phi, which is proportional to ISH, is also a constant. So DC shunt motor is known as constant flux motor. Okay? So for a DC shunt motor, flux will remain constant. Number of conductors are constant. I can't change once I fabricate the machine. Poles and parallel paths are also constant. Therefore, EB is always proportional to speed. Okay. Back EMF is always proportional to speed of the motor. Now, as the result of this, what happens? If speed is high, EB is high, then IA is, IA is VB minus EV minus EB. It is negation of EB. If EB increases, V minus EB decreases. Therefore, IA is low. If speed is low, EB is low, then IA is high. If EB decreases, V minus EB increases. Say, suppose V is, say, 220 minus, say, 110. Okay, so how much I get? 110. If EB increases, 220 minus 200, how much I get? 20. So as EB increases, V minus EB decreases. If V minus EB decreases, IA decreases. If EB decreases as the speed decreases, V minus EB increases. Therefore, IA increases. So, what I can state here is armature current. This is an important point, okay? This is an important point. Armature current in DC shunt motor depends on speed of the motor. Okay. So, shall we take a break of 10 minutes? I want to continue. What you say, it is up to you.